So. What's interesting with your specific case is the world has an opinion. It's not just the Philippines. The European Union has made a statement on the clearing of the charge. Amnesty International is calling on the Marcos administration to investigate those responsible for your incarceration. No less than the U.S. State Department is urging the Marcos administration to resolve all politically motivated cases in the Philippines. Let's start with just the breadth, the length, and the expanse of the impact of your incarceration and your release.
Yes, definitely. The world was extremely interested about my case.
Yeah.
And that's why all of these international organizations and certain governments, foreign governments, the US, European countries, the EU especially, they monitored the developments in my cases almost from day one. And from time to time, they were releasing also statements calling for my release and calling for the immediate disposition of the cases. So I feel so blessed that the world really was watching my cases, because they know. I mean, they have information. They have embassies here. These foreign governments have embassies here, have representatives here. They do their own research. And they would know whether a particular case or cases filed against a personality, a political personality, is legitimate or not.
Or trumped up.
Or yeah. Trumped up.
Mm-mm. Okay. You said to former President Duterte, kayo ngayon ang mananagot. So let's get specific. Now that all cases have been dismissed, how do you plan to move forward? This is now justice for Leila de Lima, for you personally, the 7 years lost. Let's start with that first. What are your plans?
Okay. Yes, the other day I attained justice and vindication. Indeed, if all your cases, especially criminal cases, and the three of them carried supposedly the penalty of life imprisonment, if convicted, it was, you know, it is justice for me. It is also vindication for me, because I've been saying I'm totally innocent of those charges, because these are simply fabricated. So justice and vindication. Vindication before those especially who doubted my innocence, and even before those who continue to doubt my innocence. So both justice and vindication. But for me personally, and I think and I hope that people would understand that it cannot be full justice and vindication or complete vindication until and unless those responsible for the political persecution, for the fabrication of these charges, are held accountable or are made to answer, because they did inflict a lot of wrongs upon my person, upon my dignity, upon my honor, upon my liberty. 7 years of being deprived of liberty is no small matter. Mm. And especially if you're innocent. Mm. So I'm not doing this for any vindictive purpose or for simply out of vengefulness. Mm-mm. I just want to tell the world that, and to tell, you know, like-minded authoritarian leaders, that they cannot just do that without accountability in the end.
Because I agree with you, because if you don't, ang iisipin ng tao, panapanahon lang yan eh. Nung panahon ni Duterte, ayan, nakulong siya. Ngayong wala na si Duterte, libre na siya. Ganyan talaga ang buhay. Right? So ang tanong ko, will you file for damages? What are you planning to file?
Okay, my legal team, because of course, before the dismissal the other day of this last case, they needed to focus first on the cases. And then after that, they're now studying. Although they started studying the legal options, what specific cases are to be filed against whom? Not just Mr. Duterte, but some other individuals who were his accomplices in the persecution. Now, but we cannot yet disclose what specific cases, but damages could be one. And of course, it's about malicious prosecution, false prosecution, and then damages, and then libel, perjury against certain witnesses. So these are all in the list of the possible options or possible cases. But we cannot make a categorical announcement until the entire study is completed and we're able, that my lawyers would be able to decide exactly what cases, because we do not want just to be filing cases without sufficient supporting proof. We would not want cases like that to just get dismissed for lack of sufficient evidence. It has to be something that we will seriously pursue and would be confident of its of a positive outcome.
Because what the public has to realize is, let's say, a possible case against the former president for the drug war and the deaths is a different case.
Yes.
But this case is the injustice committed to you.
Yes.
Specifically.
Yes.
And it could get as high as the Supreme Court. There's 4 years to go. If you do win in the lower court, this could be a precedent for political prisoners, so to speak.
Yes.
Right? That the Supreme Court will make a decision that could teach every administration that you can't just do this.
Exactly. So that's the very message that we want to deliver, that cases like this cannot just be allowed to, or cases of injustice and persecution like this cannot just be allowed to die down. And because it's about also the strong principles of justice and accountability, strong principles about, you know, you cannot be abusive when you're in power.
So. Now, here's an interesting one for you. Former presidential spokesperson Sal Panelo said the court committed a grave error in dismissing your case. He says the court considered the recantation of the testimonies against you, even if he says there was no evidence of coercion, threats, or psychological pressure with those witnesses. And then Panelo added is, why do you want justice? And I'm rephrasing, for the 7 years jail time, he says, it's not an injustice that you were in jail, but a and I'm quoting verbatim here, a punishment for her persecution of former President Duterte when he was mayor of Davao. In other words, you deserve to be punished, he said, because you persecuted the former mayor.
But it's a stupid thing to say. In the first place. No, it's a stupid thing to say that it is a grave error. Because, you know, the court, and I'm talking about the courts in the three cases also, not just the recent one, the one who handled the last case. They scrutinize the evidence, and especially this third case. If you see the order, both the order granting bail last November 13, 2023, and the present order granting the demurrer to evidence of all accused, it is so exhaustively done. So you could see that the judge exhaustively examined the records and meticulously scrutinized the merits or demerits of the various testimonies. And during the, after the bail hearing, when he granted bail, he did say there that after scrutinizing the testimonies, and not just the direct testimonies of these witnesses, which we consider as perjured witnesses, but also the cross-examination, the direct, redirect examination, and the cross-examination. And the court categorically found that the testimonies are simply not credible. There's a lot of incredulities, a lot of inconsistencies, and many of them are hearsay evidence. So it was an exhaustive discussion and justifying the ruling of the court. So in the end, the court said in the bail hearing, evidence of guilt is not strong.
Yeah.
The prosecution failed to prove that the evidence is strong. And so the prosecution proceeded with the presentation of their evidence in chief. Now, after the presentation of other witnesses in the evidence in chief presentation, the court said nothing substantive was added. The status, the very status of the evidence during the bail hearing, which was insufficient, remains the same.
Yeah.
So it was not fortified, because that's supposed to be the challenge to the prosecution when bail was granted.
Yeah.
Challenge to the prosecution when the court said there's no that the evidence of guilt is not strong. So since bail was granted, the prosecution is supposed to present more evidence which they think are stronger, but they failed to do that.
Yeah, that's one. Okay, the next is, what about the comment of it wasn't an injustice to essentially put you in jail because it's a punishment for your persecution? There seems to be a thinking that your persecution was personal.
That very statement actually betrays the reason for the filing of cases. So it's not about that I was allegedly involved in illegal drug trade.
That's interesting.
That I was conspiring, or I conspired with all those drug lords in the New Bilibid prison. So they're now saying, and they're now admitting, that they filed cases against me, they jailed me as a punishment for the investigations that I conducted against Mr. Duterte.
So ironically, Panelo helped your
yes.
We were crying.
We were crying all along. Persecution.
Yeah.
This is not a prosecution, but persecution. With that kind of statement, it says it all. No, he just confirmed what you were saying all along. So this is not an honest to goodness case, but simply to get back at me, as in his words, punishment for my alleged persecution of Mr. Duterte. And I categorically deny that I engage in any kind of persecution against Mr. Duterte, because I was just doing my job, both as a CHR chairperson then, when investigating the DDS killings, and when as a senator, the EJ case committed under the war on drugs.
So let's give a brief history here to the viewers who may have forgotten. So when you were once the chair of the Commission on Human Rights, and you started in an investigation into the Davao Death Squad. To be fair, when Duterte was not yet president.
Mayor, still
yeah,
mayor.
He was still mayor, and you already started that investigation. There was no inkling from anyone that he would be president or even run for president. So you really initiated that investigation based on reports that you got as CHR chair.
Correct.
When you won as a senator, you continued the investigation but widened it already to the EJK killings of the drug war.
Yes.
And you were the only senator doing that.
Yes. I was the only senator who filed the resolution as early as July 13. So that's just about 13 days from assumption into office of the elected officials then, from the president all the way down in 2016. Because July 1 was the assumption into office. June 30 was the oath taking. But since I saw already, even before the assumption into office, but from right after the elections, killings started to happen almost on a daily basis. So I didn't lose time. I didn't waste any time. And I decided to file it 13 days after assumption into office, our assumption into office, him as a president, and me as a senator. And some were actually dissuading me from doing that. It's too early. He might again, you will certainly again incur his ire. Remember in 2009, the CHR DDS killings, the probe into the DDS killings. But I said, how many more deaths should we wait when every day people are dying? At that point, it was about 500 plus deaths in the name of the war on drugs.
Was it about the Duterte cases that got you really passionate about it? I mean, I'm sure that when you were CHR head, there were other killings that were brought to the office. And then as a senator, if that were another senator with the victory of Duterte then with 16 million votes, some would have dropped it for a while, right? Kumbaga, palamig muna. But not you. What was it about?
It's the brazenness and the impunity. And it's because I'm a human rights defender, I'm a human rights advocate. And I would.
So you were appalled with that?
I was definitely appalled. It's a violation, a serious, egregious violation of the fundamental right to life, the fundamental right against deprivation of life. So you cannot just kill people just like that. Whatever is the fault, whatever is the crime committed, and we all know that not all of those killed, the alleged drug offenders, were really involved in drugs, because there were those who were killed under mistaken identity.
Yes, and some teenagers.
Some teenagers, minors.
Children, let's not forget that.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, they called them collateral damage.
Which was unacceptable to me. And I could see the pattern right away that he simply brought into the national scene what he was doing when he was mayor of Davao, those DDS killings that we investigated, that the CHR has investigated. So I cannot take this sitting down. I cannot just sit idly by and seeing people got butchered almost on a daily basis. Mm. There ought to be accountability.
You know, before we move on to the ICC, I think what I've always said about you that was interesting was the fact that after 7 years, you've come out of it with grace, with a sense of resilience. And that's not easy. I don't know how people would be if they were incarcerated innocently for 7 years. Some have been more. We've talked about it. You have a Nelson Mandela that's 25. You have other prisoners too. But then how did you do it?
Oh, so this is one of the blessings actually of being incarcerated, especially unjustly incarcerated. You really have to be strong and you really have to persist. Mm-mm. In your faith in the good Lord. Mm. And because, you know, I knew exactly why that was done to me. I knew exactly the reason why they filed those cases, had me arrested and jailed, because they wanted to silence me and not proceed with the investigation. So I was very conscious of that in my psyche. I would always tell myself, you've got to remain strong. You cannot let these people, the perpetrators of these crimes, these heinous crimes, these crimes against humanity, win or triumph by seeing me bitten.
Mm. Now, the lower house, I believe, plans to invite you and former President Duterte to the drug war probe. I'm curious, have you received an invitation?
No, not yet. I just... learned about it in the news that the three of us would be invited by the House Committee.
Would you attend if you're invited?
Of course. If there's an invitation, there's no reason for me to decline it.
Mm. Okay. Now, you did say that you will cooperate with the ICC. You want to help the ICC. Are you now a resource person for the ICC as we speak today?
Well, I cannot yet confirm that. You know, because, you know, ICC proceedings are actually supposed to be deemed confidential. Mm. There are certainly groups, there are certain individuals that are helping out. Mm. Now, I'm one of them, but as to whether exactly how we are helping, I don't think we can specifically say, because the investigation is still ongoing.
Mm, okay. What stage is the ICC in its investigation?
I think it's about to wrap up its investigation. Because if I'm not mistaken, they resume the investigation in 2023, July of 2023. It was first deferred because the government, the Philippine government, appealed the ruling or the decision of the pretrial chamber to authorize authorize the investigation, the ICC investigation. Mm-hmm. And also when the ICC decided to resume the investigation, again, the Philippine government appealed it. It filed its appeal brief before the trial chamber of the ICC. And again, it was denied by the ICC. And so It has resumed. Now, I would like to think that it's now in its final stages.
Okay, so it's about to wrap up. Now, President Marcos Jr. has ordered the Department of Justice to study the legal options of the Philippines, and I believe his own legal options when it comes to rejoining the tribunal, but they've also prepared a briefer on what measures the president could take in case the ICC orders the arrest of former President Duterte. Now, being a legal luminary, tell me, give me a big picture. We're not a member, so technically they don't have jurisdiction.
I'd like to correct that.
Go ahead.
It's not accurate to really say that the ICC has no jurisdiction over the alleged crimes of humanity, which is the subject of their investigation.
Even if we are not a member.
Even if we withdrew already, because the scope of the ongoing investigation is during the period that we were still a member. That is from 2011, when we acceded to the Rome Statute, and up to 2019, when the withdrawal by Mr. Duterte became effective. So that's from 2011 to 2019. And the Supreme Court itself has made a ruling, a pronouncement in Pangilinan versus Cayetano case, that the ICC is not divested of its jurisdiction to investigate the crimes said to have been committed at the time that we are still member. So it's not ousted of its jurisdiction simply because we ultimately, or Mr. Duterte withdrew the Philippines ultimately from the Rome Statute or the ICC. So it has jurisdiction. But then the issuance of the warrant of arrest, that is now the touchy issue. Yes. You know, it's touchy because all this time the BBM administration has been saying that we are no longer engaging with the ICC. At first they engaged by filing, for example, the request for deferment and also the appeal brief. So they did engage, so they're now stopped. From
engaging, it means you recognize.
You were recognizing the jurisdiction. You cannot just say now we are not anymore, we can no longer cooperate because there's no jurisdiction anymore, when in the first place you recognize its jurisdiction by filing those documents. Mm-hmm. Now, we're looking forward, of course, to that study, because I don't think it has been, I'm not sure if the DOJ has submitted the legal study already, supposedly containing the options of the BBM administration once the warrant of arrest has been issued.
Okay.
Now, the BBM administration can now say that this means that indeed the ICC was serious. It means that the ICC did its job in investigating, and it means that it really found enough cause to indict Mr. Duterte. And therefore, with this warrant of arrest, we are reneging from our commitment when we were still member to act in bad faith, in good faith, when the ICC chooses to really assert its jurisdiction. Okay. It's not an excuse that since we have already withdrawn from Rome Statute and from ICC, we are not cooperating anymore in the enforcement. The BBM administration can still aid in the enforcement of the warrant of arrest.
How? That's interesting. You said the BBM administration can aid in the enforcement of the warrant of arrest. What do you mean by that?
Allowing, for example, the arresting team, the team of prosecutors, the representatives from the office of the prosecutor
in the country,
to come in the country. And then make sure that there would be an orderly enforcement of the warrant of arrest, that it will not move to prevent the service or the enforcement of the warrant. But then again, we still expect some protracted proceedings there.
Okay.
I'm almost certain that the Duterte camp would still exhaust certain remedies, like going to a Philippine court to question the warrant of arrest, primarily on the ground of what they're saying, that the ICC has no jurisdiction anymore, even if it's a fallacious argument. So it would take time. And then even if the warrant of arrest would ultimately be served, for example, he does not escape, that is, if he does not escape from the Philippines and hide, then even before the ICC, his lawyers would also be availing of certain remedies and continue to assert their or argue on their position that the ICC is without jurisdiction.
Okay. Now, so far, the ICC has publicly indicted 57 people. Proceedings against 25 are ongoing. Well, this is what the latest from the ICC. 20 are at large as fugitives and 5 are on trial. So this could be further updated. But my question is, only 2 are serving sentences. 7 have finished sentences. 4 have been acquitted. 7 have had the charges against them dismissed, etc. So just to let the viewers know that the ICC has had success in indicting and actually putting leaders and people to jail. But would you know of an instance, ma'am, where the ICC was able to arrest a former leader in his or her own country?
Actually, I don't remember right now.
Interesting.
I have to research on that. But we have to also consider the fact that ICC really has serious challenges when it comes to handling cases and when it comes also to enforcement of warrants of arrest. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's not easy to be looking into these kinds of crimes, especially, you know, that normally the ones involved are really powerful personalities. And that is the very, you know, that is why the ICC was created, was established. Because maybe to a certain extent, the justice system of certain countries would be working or are working, but there are situations when the ICC need to intervene because of, you know, the specific circumstances of a country where the particular leader who is the subject of the investigation really wields so much power that nobody and nothing under the domestic mechanisms of accountability would work for in terms of making him accountable.
Okay, we're going to go to a quick break and change gears here. But before we go on this one, I want to ask you, do you think President Marcos Jr. should aid in the arrest of former President Duterte if an arrest warrant is issued by the ICC? Will this have a backlash on President Marcos? Or will this be good for his legacy? I mean, given the right thing to do is a whole other issue. But, you know, at the end of the day, there's politics involved. Should he do it?
He must do it. I've been saying that he must cooperate. He should be cooperating by now in the investigation, even without yet the arrest warrant. And if the arrest warrant is there already, he must consider aiding the enforcement of that warrant of arrest. It would be good for the international community. It would be good for the community of nations that we are for justice and accountability always. Mm-hmm. That this government, you know, despite also all the struggles and all the challenges that it is facing, it is ready and determined to stand its ground when it comes to issues of justice and accountability, because we're talking here about thousands of victims.
So you believe this is the litmus test for President Marcos Jr. when he says he is for human rights?
Yes, definitely.
But do you think he'll do it? Because, you know, reporters have asked him about addressing the human rights victims during his father's time. And he said it's not for him to do. What do you think? Do you have faith he would?
Well, this is, you know, this is one opportune time or moment for him to show that indeed he stands for justice, to show that he also promotes and protects human rights. Maybe it's understandable that he would not be taking steps insofar as holding his father's regime accountable for the wrongs, also for the various kinds of human rights. But this time around, you're now the president. And then you're talking here about the abuses of the wrongs, the crimes committed by your predecessor. Show to the world that you can do it. Show to the world that you stand for what is right.
Speaking politics now, all right. Is the Liberal Party, is the time of the Liberal Party, frankly, I hope you don't get insulted with this, but over,
no,
right?
You don't believe? Not at all.
Okay.
I don't believe that. Yes, we're struggling because our numbers have been diminished, have been decimated because of the demonization hurled against the Liberal Party, especially during the last administration. Talaga namang siniraan nila na husto ang Liberal Party, the Dilawans, etc. Rightly or wrongly, and many have really jumped ship. Many have, you know how it is. Our political party system is such a weak political party system that being a member of a party is not really taken seriously by many because they will just be using the party for electoral purposes. And after the elections, they would jump into the ruling party.
But is it just that? Because the symbolic figurehead of the Liberal Party is, let me finish, is, let's say, Leni Robredo. And she ran with a different color. She was pink. And then you have Bam Aquino, who's running for the Senate again, and he's not running under the LP. So is it already a time where your colleagues, your very symbols, want to distance themselves from the Liberal Party because of the image that it has, that it's not inclusive, it's all about the Aquinos? You know, yun ang tanong ko eh.
Well, you're just stating the fact that really the Liberal Party would seem to be a turnoff to some.
Yeah.
You know, but I refuse to accept that. I refuse to just go along with that kind of mentality or perception of the party. Because insofar as the Liberal Party is concerned, we are standing for the right principles. We are standing for the right values in political life, like transparency, accountability, anti-corruption, anti-authoritarianism, participatory and good governance. Mm. Those are the very principles, the bedrock of our party, and we've been consistent. The Liberal Party has been consistent about espousing and advocating those advocacies. And that's why ang mga natitira sa Liberal Party ay yung talagang naniniwala sa pinaninindigan ng Liberal Party. And may I also correct you there that VP Leni is still a member of the Liberal Party, although as you said, during the last elections, she opted to run independent, you know, for purpose of expansion of the base. Because, you know, we were being realistic about it, that we would court more supporters if it's not just limited to the label of the Liberal Party.
Okay, but when Leni runs for mayor of Naga, what will she be under, the Liberal Party?
We would think so.
Okay.
She still remains to be the Liberal Party. Although with respect to running as a mayor, I think we can just wait also for the official announcement from VP Leni herself. But that is what we're getting from her.
Yeah.
That she's more interested to run as mayor for Naga City. Her option does not include running for senator next year, although there are still people, there are still groups that are hoping that she would change her mind and reconsider.
Do you think she can win for the Senate? I mean, with political landscape now.
Yes.
The 16 million. How many voted for VP Leni?
16 million. Yes.
So the 16 million, you believe, would be there and more?
Correct. The kakampings are actually still there. Mm. You know, most of the chapters are actually still active. And some are just waiting for, you know, the right mobilization and the right encouragement for them to be active again. So when they would see VP Leni to be, you know, again, to reconsider, when they see that VP Leni would reconsider for the Senate, then they would again be rejuvenated and then come out and to help her. But we always would respect the decision of VP Leni.
I'm curious, are you thinking of running for the Senate?
No.
At all? Why not?
It's difficult.
Okay.
It's difficult. And you know, after what I went through, and I need really a lot of time to think about a lot of things also.
Mm. Well, number one, you're not a politician. Remember when you were Justice Secretary and you were asked to run for the Senate, you did head start and you were unsure then. And yes. I think you were sitting in power then. Yes. You were unsure.
Yes, because I decided, I think, to run for the 2016 elections just a few weeks before the filing of the certificate of candidacy in October. If I'm not mistaken, last week of August or first week of September was my decision when the former President Pinoy, the late President Pinoy, and also Sec Maro has talked to me and convinced me to run. So okay. the same now. I'm not considering running for the Senate.
Okay, well, there are some people apparently considering to run. Mm-hmm. So you have former President Duterte, Paulo Duterte, Bastet Duterte, three Dutertes, okay? Now, what's your reaction hearing that the three Dutertes want to run?
My initial reaction is to doubt the seriousness of that announcement.
Okay, why?
What is this? Is this just a gimmickry or some kind of, you know, pakulo lang, para, and some kind of diversion? And then remember also that the announcement came a day after the release of my order, of the order in my last case. Now, so what is this? This could also be diversionary. But with the political happenings now, you know, the no longer the unity team, now no longer DepEd secretary, and then of course the Duterte camp has been finding ways and means to really show to the people that they're still around, that they cannot just be counted out and ruled out. So it's a display of power, show of force. But then again, I don't know. Ang dami ng problema, may mga problema tayo sa bansa. So ano na, marami tayo mga sa West Philippine Sea, and then yung ano nga yung elusive accountability or justice for the victims of the drug war. And then certain fugitives from justice not facing their charges. Now,
but that protects them. Exactly. By running and winning, it protects them.
Yes, but are they offering solutions to the real problems of our country when they're part of the problem? I would say that they're really part of the problem. You know, the things that they did during their time, during the Duterte regime, some of the problems are inherited by the current administration. So what are they thinking? What are they trying to do? They're probably just wreaking havoc on our political system. And another thing, Karen, is that, you know, it's very disheartening that we could see these things again happening. Na meron na naman isang dynasty na papasok na naman sa national level. Because Congress has been derelict in its duty, supposedly, to enact an enabling anti-dynasty law. But then the Constitution is still clear. The spirit and the principle behind the Constitution, which is against political dynasties, is still there. So the least that these politicians can do, the least that these members of dynasties can do, is to respect the very spirit and philosophy of the Constitution.
But then I wanted to ask you this, because I think this is a commentary on the state of the Senate today, and I don't mean to say this personally against anyone, but if you're a Duterte, you're thinking, I'm not doing anything new. It started with Loy Ejercito and Jingoy, mother and son. You have two Cayetanos in the Senate now. You have Cynthia Villar, mother and son, Cynthia and Mark in the Senate. Am I missing somebody else? I mean, at one point, I thought there would be two Binays in the Senate too, but there wasn't. So it was alarming already then that, you know, there are only 24 seats. Really, do you need two family members, right, in the
Senate?
And
simultaneously.
I mean, so if you're a Duterte, you're thinking, well, they're doing it. Why don't we all do it? Because we're going to win most probably, right?
But then again, kaya nga nakakalungkot. No, we still don't have the enabling anti-dynasty law, because it emboldens powerful people like that, or powerful families like that, to do it.
To sit at the same time.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, and not only the Senate, of course, in the House of Representatives, mm-hmm. more and more members of dynasties mm-hmm. are being elected.
Yeah. Okay. Now, Attorney Harry Roque has said that Vice President Sara Duterte is the new opposition. Some have told me, I've had a discussion about this, that the opposition just means somebody who's against the administration. Would you consider her the new opposition, or it's just another power block?
It's just another power block, but it's not the real opposition. Mm. As you know, the LP has issued a statement strongly, vehemently objecting to that representation, that they're now the real opposition. Just because you're out of the kitchen, you cannot just say you're the opposition now. Just because you claim to be, you know, you'll be running against or you'll be fighting the one in power now, you're now the opposition. You have to do something more. You have to represent more. You should have values, you should have principles. You have really a concrete platform of governance that would compete with the current administration. Mm-hmm. So they've got to do more and prove themselves more to be considered as an opposition.
Okay. Now, we don't have enough time, but just to end, I wanted to ask you, now that you're completely free, that's really the word, are you going to travel soon for talks? Because one of the issues with you, Maria Ressa, et cetera, is you have whole departure orders. Did you have one?
None.
You didn't have one?
None.
No, before?
None.
When you were out on bail?
When
you were out on bail, didn't you have an HDO?
None.
Interesting.
When the cases are still there, yeah. and I'm still in jail, in detention.
Yes, of course you couldn't travel.
I couldn't travel.
No, but then recently when you were...
There's no such condition in the bail. But the rule, the policy is that you should ask for the court permission.
Okay, roughly the same.
But the prosecution did not ask for HDO.
Okay.
They know yeah. that I'm not a flight risk.
So what would you do now? I mean, now that you're completely free.
Well, I must tell you that there are really standing invitations yes. for foreign engagements. Well, local, of course, there are many invitations for domestic engagements. There are several. But I'm still thinking also about it, although...
Why not?
My team. Yeah, because...
Why are you thinking about it?
Well, nakakapagod din eh, you know.
Physically, you mean?
Physically, nakakapagod din. And... of course, I there would be a time when I would be acceding or would be obliging those investigation and those invitation, because I'd also like to thank the world. I also would like to thank the various groups that have supported me and tell my story. But that's what I'm doing now, locally. Whenever I go around, people are interested to know my story and also want to tell my story to the world.
Yeah.
But then it's just a matter of coming up with a good schedule.
Yeah.
And because I it would be really very... tiresome.
Okay, but I think you should, though. But at the end, if you were to describe your whole experience, your whole ordeal, how would you describe it?
It's liberating. It's cleansing, purifying, and strengthening.
On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, former Senator Leila de Lima. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.